So thank you for inviting me. You make very good points, and this will be an interesting conversation, I think. I'm really thankful to the Weaver family for allowing this event to occur tonight, and for inviting me, and helping us to engage in this very complex discussion around this very complicated issue. I have no financial conflicts of interest. I am an advocate for legal access, just so you know. So I come to this with a point of view, as I think Farr does as well. So why are palliative options of last resort important? Many people have witnessed a bad death. Like, we could have a show of hands here. How many of you have seen a bad death in your lifetime? And I might ask, how many of you have seen bad deaths on hospice? So they do happen from time to time. The possibility of an escape when suffering gets intolerable is very important to some people, and that really drives most of this, the possibility that there could be an escape. And for some people, knowing that there could be options is really important in terms of how they approach the end of their lives. So I'm a real hospice fan, but this is not an alternative to hospice. This is Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. I see her as the symbolic mother of the hospice movement in the United States. Did this wonderful thing when she awakened us that people who are dying have a life to live and a lot of things to teach us. And we also, palliative care has sort of taken what hospice has taught us and moved it back further. So we're going to, at the same time, we're picking and choosing the treatments that still might be helpful. We're going to try to do some of the same things that hospice has taught us. Manage symptoms really well, talk with people about what's really going on, think about their spiritual lives and what they have left to do with their lives. So we have really moved forward a lot in the last 25 or 30 years in terms of humanizing the last part of our lives and the parts of our lives that we get sicker. But I think we all know that there are going to be tough cases if we take care of people all the way through this process. It just is the nature of the beast. So I'm a real expert in hospice care, and I believe that I can be very reassuring. But I know that when I was a hospice medical director, there was always one or two or five cases, depending on the size of the program, at any given time, where suffering was real high, and all the wonderful things that we do in hospice were really not quite enough. And some of those patients had the audacity to ask us, can't we just put an end to this? And so part of what we're trying to do is figure out how can we respond to those kinds of circumstances. Now again, sometimes when people are suffering, it's because we're not doing a good job at palliative care. So the first place to go is always to redouble our efforts to make sure we're doing everything in our power to relieve suffering. And again, some of these changes are improving. They're clearly not at all perfect right now. We're improving access, although that's a little bit on the ropes right now with our change in leadership. We are training more physicians in these areas. Pain management, again, has gone into flux a little bit right now. We're seeing it as more complicated. Often when we offer palliative care too late, it's too late. And we somehow say it's okay if doctors don't do great palliative care. These things are still works in progress. I think we've made progress, but we have a ways to go. But there are some limitations of palliative care that are not correctable. So when we tell people that we can relieve 100% of their suffering, I think, frankly, we scare them. Because if they end up in a tough situation, we're gonna say, well, that's not for us. It's for somebody else. It's not our responsibility. So we have to learn how to acknowledge the exceptions, and sometimes those exceptions are uncontrolled physical symptoms, and again, pain is our best case scenario. We're pretty good at pain. Shortness of breath, a little harder to get simply reassuring about. Things like nausea and vomiting and delirium, really harder to get simply reassuring about. And then if we're going to talk about suffering, we got to talk about psychosocial, existential, and spiritual suffering, and the notion that we would have answers to all of those dimensions of suffering is just preposterous. It's too complex. We try, but they're and the experience of an individual patient is often an amalgam of these things. It's not one dimension. They don't have the luxury of separating out what one level versus another. And furthermore, the dependency and side effects of some of our treatments are beyond what some people want to go through. And we can say that Brittany Maynard should have been able to tolerate being dependent and allowing her brain tumor to run its natural course, but with it, that may not be our role to say what she should and shouldn't be able to do. And again, it may be not a doctor's role, I think we could debate that, but I think it's hard to judge her for wanting to think about that and wanting to perhaps skip the last part of that. So again, and we devalue some patients' choices. So if somebody's on a life support and they say, it's my time, I'm ready to go, the answer from us palliative care types is, listen to the patient, they know what they want, and we allow them to go off the life supports. But take that same patient, perhaps suffering 10 times more with no life support to stop, and they start saying, I'm really ready to go, I want to stop now, the answer is they must be depressed. Or this is outside of our realm, that we don't want to deal with that. And that just doesn't seem fair. So there are interlocking policy questions. We have to improve access and delivery of palliative care and hospice services to all seriously ill patients. And then we have to figure out how to respond to those infrequent but troubling patients who are dying badly despite excellent care. And then the question is, do we respond to individual cases underneath the radar screen or around the radar screen, or should we develop public policy so that we respond out in the open? And there's one population that's relatively small, and that's the group that actually needs this kind of help in earnest, but there's a much bigger population about people who are worried about what things are going to look like down the road. And I think that's what drives the public debate around assisted dying. So the people who want to talk about what's it going to look like down the road are asking, who's going to work with me? And we're going to be asking them, what are they most afraid about? What kinds of deaths have they seen in their family? Again, when they've seen pain that was undertreated, I breathe a huge sigh of relief because I know pain. I really feel like we have good answers for that. But if they have more complicated things that they've witnessed, I think the reassurance gets a little more difficult. I will say that those who know that they have a doctor partner who will see this process through with them, wherever it goes, really have a leg up. But they can then face the latter part of their lives with a lot less fear. So a lot of people are worried about this in theory, but a small number will actually end up in a situation toward the very end of their life where they're ready to die now. And again, this should be the beginning of an exploration. Where we try to figure out why now, and there's a differential diagnosis in medicine for this. It might be uncontrolled symptoms, it might be psychosocial problem, a spiritual crisis. They might have gotten depressed, so they're not seeing their situation clearly, or are very anxious. In which case, we're going to try to address those things that are addressable and see if they can refine the will to keep going. But it might also be that they are experiencing uncontrolled and intolerable suffering. That is unacceptable to them. And if that is the situation, then we have to face up to that. So we're going to make sure that palliative care is being done well, that we've looked at all the options, and then we're going to search for the least harmful way to respond that respects the values of the major participants. The major participants, patient, immediate family, and the clinicians who were involved in the case with them. Patient-informed consent and full participation. And these are the options. By the way, this is kind of what we do on a regular basis in palliative care. So again, if the issue was pain, we're going to be upping the pain medicine. We're going to accept the fact that there's a risk that we might be shortening life a little bit, because untreated pain is much worse than unintentionally hastening death. And there's wide agreement that this is permissible. If they're on any life-sustaining therapies, we're going to give them the option of stopping it. And again, some of them are the big ones that you see, like breathing machines or dialysis machines. And some of them are more subtle, like steroids for a brain cancer or something like that. They can be stopped, even if the patient's intent is to die earlier. So again, they can tell us very directly if they have a life support what they really want. And we're gonna say that they know what they want. But if they're not on a life support, we're going into gray areas. And there are some gray areas that have developed, like the option of stopping eating and drinking. Now, this is not the natural part of not eating and drinking that happens at the very end of life. It's a conscious choice to stop eating and drinking. Again, kind of radical when you first think about it, and it's a little bit hard to do, but it is an option that people might have that isn't assisted dying. Palliative sedation is done in palliative care circles quite commonly. There's actually huge variation between programs and how frequently people go to this. Some programs do it a whole lot, some programs do it rarely. And again, this is pretty close to euthanasia, but there are some differences which we might discuss later on. And then physician-assisted death or physician-assisted suicide, which is what the main focus of tonight, involuntary act of euthanasia. The difference is that in physician-assisted death, the doctor gives the patient the medicine that the patient takes by his or her own hand, whereas in euthanasia, the doctor administers the medication.